The Frankfurt Major Champions are now back and stronger than ever. Blessed with one of the most gifted players of the modern era in Miracle, Crit and his teammates create the space for this 9K MMR prodigy to work his magic. A blend of character and charisma, this team is on the brink of a return to dominance after being humbled in Shanghai. This could be their moment. Welcome on stage, OG! Aggression with high class entertainment. They will come out guns blazing, and with the first generation boy wonder Dendy back at his best, these Daredevils are here to compete, making their first appearance at a Dota 2 Major. Welcome on stage.
I don't think we have any doubt who the crowd favourite are here in Manila. It's Na'Vi versus OG, the second game of the day, second series of the day in the upper bracket. Just a reminder for you at home, best of three in the upper bracket. Later on today, four best of ones to decide who stays in and who goes home. Let's focus on the matchup at hand with our gentlemen once more. Let's start with Na'Vi. Kevin, I don't want to get too carried away because it's easy to get under the, you know, the crowd hype and everything else is going great for them right now, and they've been playing super well. Came through the group stage with a 4-0, but that's not the entire story for them, is it?
Yeah, the part that we really need to bring up is what private talks were like leading into it. Everyone was talking about scrims versus Na'Vi. They were saying very negative things. Even in Dendy's interview after he won his first set, he was like, "Yeah, we lost all of our scrims yesterday," and then they just start winning. It's been incredible, and it could continue, but I'm not sure if it will.
I remember on like the first day actually when we got here, because I used to be part of Na'Vi US, so I know the Na'Vi manager. So I went up to him and I was chatting with him a bit, and I was like, you know, how are you guys feeling? And he was just like, outside of the game, great. We have massive cohesion synergy. Inside the game, some problems. Mm. So now to be seeing this change up, it's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Fogg can do that to pretty much any team here because he's played for all of them. Charlie, as a manager of EG, what have you been able to find out about the Na'Vi hype train? Is it real?
Right now, it's real.
Okay.
And you know what? It might continue. You look at OG on paper. They're the more accomplished team. They beat them at DreamHack. And you would think that OG should take this. Mm. But, you know, I think Na'Vi actually has a great play style against OG. OG wants to take it late. They want to give Miracle farm. But Na'Vi is great at pressuring. Na'Vi is great at playing that early game. And the style that they found against Secret and against DC, I think they might be able to take this.
Okay, I also want to bring up the point of view of sandbagging. Okay, we spoke a little bit about this in the group stage. Some players, some teams, they're holding things back because they're focusing on different things. Maybe Liquid are focusing on TI. Maybe Na'Vi have focused on this, and maybe that's why they lost all their scrims.
I don't think they're intentionally losing scrims.
No, obviously
maybe
not.
They're holding
maybe
their strats back.
Out, yeah.
Maybe they're not trying as hard because they might think they are, but it's not the real game,
isn't
so they don't
the
have the same energy.
Isn't this the ultimate mind game, though, Charlie?
Isn't this the ultimate mind game? No. This isn't happening. Sorry. It's not a
thing. But Charlie, you love these mind games.
Yeah, I love them when I'm playing against you guys.
Oh, okay.
And I love tilting the Haas, right. But in scrims, no, these guys are trying their hardest. When you lose like 5 scrims in a row or something, it's definitely not on purpose.
Right.
And then it damages your confidence. It damages your psyche. It's not something that you want to do on purpose. No, you want to win these. You want to build confidence, especially a team like Na'Vi that rides on confidence.
Yeah.
You see that with their win over Secret in DC. They should be coming into this series with a lot of confidence.
Okay, let's take a look at OG. Recent successes aside, it's taken them a little while to come back in force. And we saw them at the Major in Frankfurt last year go through the lower bracket. Not something we'd seen much of before. EG, had done it once before at a large-scale event. It's not something we see every day. They did that, and they had a period of dominance of 2 or 3 weeks around that patch that just seemed to be unbeatable. But since then, gone off the boil. And then recently came back to the fore. Why is that?
Yeah, they really outperformed at Epicenter. Everybody thought that they were going to be kind of like how Secret and EG are performing lately, just that they're on the down and it wasn't going to get better. But at Epicenter, they had super good performances. They didn't end up winning the tournament, but they got pretty far than most people thought. This tournament so far, they've been mostly good. They got 2-0'd by Newbie, which is a little iffy for them. They 2-0'd Empire, and then they played Empire again and 2-1 them. So there isn't that much data for them winning, actually. In some ways, they could have just gotten 2-0'd by Newbie and then been better than Empire, but that's not saying that much. So I have a lot of faith in OG. I think they're definitely going to go far, but I don't have full confidence based on their stats. But in their play, I think they look really good.
Okay, yep. Time for predictions, because I'm hearing that the players are ready for the draft. So Charlie, we'll start with you. 2-for-3 so far, says Knoxville. I think it's 2-for-4, but we'll go with
Knox. Hey, stats don't lie. You know what? I'm actually going to go with Na'Vi on this one.
Really?
Yeah, I'm going to.
Okay.
I know OG's the safe pick, but.
Okay, don't Na'Vi question
has momentum.
Fogged, don't question it, because you could take over here, depending on which way you go.
I mean, I'm going to say OG.
All right.
Okay.
I'm going to continue my streak of 0-3 and go for OG.
You've cursed another team.
I'm gonna keep cursing the upsets.
Okay. I feel like Na'Vi does have a lot of momentum, but just because of the previous, when I saw them play each other at Dream League, sure, it's Na'Vi basically is looking like a completely different team, but in the manner that OG played versus Na'Vi at Dream League, I just have to give them that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we're gonna look at the social media predictions in a little while, but before we do that, there is one other thing I want to bring up, which is the miracle of miracle. So let's take a look at the mid matchup, because for me, and I know from you guys' point of view, this is the key crucial matchup in this match.
Yeah.
Explain why.
I think that both these teams actually do a kind of a similar type thing in the mid lane, especially if Miracle's in the mid lane. They tend to try to, No-Tail sometimes does go in the mid lane, of course, but it does matter, because both these teams like to put a lot of pressure on that mid lane. They tend to do these dual lanes and try to emphasize that they secure that great game for their mid laner.
Mm. And Denny's stats are just so good. Those are some good numbers.
Purge is just impressed by the stats.
I think OG's numbers probably look worse than they deserve to be, though, just because of the playstyle that they do. They've done a lot of kind of all-in five-man pushing stuff, but they do it better than almost every other team. So it might be equal on kills, but they'll eventually outplay you towards the end of the game and just win. So I think their numbers are better than they looked right there.
All right, let's just find out from the social media whether they have agreed with Charlie or whether they've agreed with the other two. So Na'Vi, 63-37 on Twitch.
What a surprise.
Okay. No real surprise there. Do we have the Twitter ones as well? Yes, we do.
Oh, wow.
70-30 in favor of Na'Vi.
So does that mean Charlie's right?
Hello?
Nope.
I don't think so.
I think that
nope.
makes Charlie a meme, doesn't it?
Well. Do you remember the community predictions for Na'Vi as well? They were very, very high.
They were, yeah. I mean, it's popular support, right?
Definitely.
It's a similar thing with Alliance being much higher than they were in the analyst thing.
I'm actually surprised to see it so heavily Na'Vi swing, though, especially with Miracle. I know he brings like a huge backing as well as No-Tail, not to take any credit from these other guys, because these guys, they've been around forever.
Yeah. Look, so nobody has the following that Dendy has.
Of course.
Flat and simple.
Yeah. Yep.
When it comes to community votes or whatever, Dendy is going to pull out ahead every single time.
Fair enough.
Okay. For me, there are three crucial parts to the OG story. One is Miracle, which we've highlighted already. Yep. The second one is that these guys are really strong in the early parts of patches. We've seen that in the previous two. And the third thing is the deep hero pool, which normally gets them out of trouble. So when you combine those three things, they should be playing really well at this tournament.
They can. I mean, everything comes down to outplaying in the game. Like, deep hero pool picks, like, yes, Miracle can play, like, 10 different heroes mid at the same efficiency, but, you know, they still have to win all the skirmishes.
And probably at the same time, if we'd let it.
I wouldn't be surprised. Though.
My one concern, though, just saying, is, like, OG sometimes takes like a little bit to just kind of ramp up in the early game, while Na'Vi kind of just runs at you and is this explosive team where they have this, like Dendy has this like amazing start and everything, while OG, yeah, like I was saying, Miracle kind of takes like his own little time to build up and the other four go do their own thing. And so I want to see how well they adapt versus Na'Vi, because it's very different than a lot of approaches other teams do.
Yeah. Mentally, Charlie, how do Na'Vi get over the hump that is OG? Because the last time they met them 3-0, time before that they lost as well. When does that become a mental block?
Whenever they allow it to become a mental block, just don't think about it. You're playing any other team, just play your own game.
Treat it from scratch.
Yeah, just play your own game. Your natural playstyle should match up well against OG. My worry for OG is if they put Miracle on like a tempo controller, that sometimes they put him on Dragon Knight, sometimes they don't put him on like the Alchemist or the Hard Carry or the Invoker, and then that's when I would start to worry for OG.
Mm. Okay, agree, disagree, Phil?
I could definitely agree. I really like seeing it when No-Tail's playing like the Space Creator. It's kind of similar to what we say with Alliance.
Yeah, with Bulldog and Loader.
Yeah, exactly. So I have to agree with Charlie.
I think if there was a different team that Na'Vi hadn't played so much recently, I think I would be more confident going, maybe saying Na'Vi could win it for sure.
So you feel like it could be a barrier.
I think OG definitely has the advantage going into it. Mm. Clearly, they've got previous history. Yeah. They're definitely ranked higher. They're performing better. But I think what happens every tournament and almost every major is everybody's expectation, including the top players, their expectations on who the best teams are, it's always off. It's always off. And you need to go into a new match, and maybe this one thing going for Na'Vi here, they say it's a tournament, everything's going wacky already, maybe we are the best team.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you can hear it every single time.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, are you saying then, Burge, that the mentality of this could affect them, Na'Vi, in terms of the way they play? Or do you feel it's just the way they've matched up that they found it difficult against OG?
I think the mentality is definitely going to be better. They won 2-0. Like, yes, they have the previous games, but they also beat two teams that they maybe were expecting to have trouble with. I think they're going to be really happy, especially considering a lot of people thought that they weren't going to do very well.
Yeah.
At least people not on Twitter or Twitch.
Well, they still have to win this best of three to.
They certainly do. We are into the draft, as you can see. We've had three bans. And is that pretty much what we expected?
Yeah, I mean, definitely the Earth Spirit.
It's definitely following the meta. Yeah.
Definitely the Earth Spirit, definitely the Beastmaster. A little surprised by the Lifestealer. I think that's more of a Na'Vi favorite hero than OG, but No-Tail can pick it up, and it is one of those fighting cores that can, you know, deal physical damage and also not take up so much space, because Miracle will need that.
Well, Miracle also does play the Lifestealer. He played it in this tournament previously, and he went like 10-1 earlier. So, but now we do see, a big change up from that last series, Phoenix first pick.
Yeah, which we've highlighted the fact that this thing. Right now, the Sunray hero has 32% win rate whilst here.
I feel like OG is going to be able to draft something that's a solution to that. I wasn't going to say Crystal Maiden, but...
Has been picked against it in a few matches.
I think it's just more of a flex pick. It's just, you can run in a lot of ways. It's a fly hero, leaves your draft very open-ended. You can jungle with it. You can also secure lanes with it. Doesn't require a lot of levels.
Do you flex pick it this early though? Like, doesn't this just mean?
No, probably not. I mean, I think they're doing it this early just because it leaves the rest of their draft open.
That's better than void. Wow, an instant Mirana pick.
Instant Mirana pick.
And it does make Miracle better in his lane. Okay. If you've got extra mana, he's going to get more value. You don't necessarily have to be there. There's value there. And it does work well with Faceless Void. You stand near the Chrono, you turn on your ultimate. Mm-hmm. Even if they interrupt it, that's still a stun on you and not a stun on an ally. There's benefits. But I just, the biggest thing about picking Crystal Maiden early is I fear a hero like Slark that's just going to eat her alive and that she can't deal with very well.
But that's like, this is like a super five Crystal Maiden fly playing, because usually I feel like OG picks like, Fly's playing a Crystal Maiden and Crit's playing like a Doom or something, let's say. So
that's true. That would help a Doom room a lot.
Agreed.
Too.
Yeah. And like half the hero pool eats Crystal Maiden alive. So yeah.
That's just my biggest problem with the hero. And she's slow.
And she's slow.
Anything else?
Anything else?
Pudge just picking OCN.
I don't want to say anything.
She's
else.
Been buffed a bunch of times now after getting heavily nerfed in a couple patches quite a long time ago.
So far, both these heroes are heroes that can set up Miracle, the CM, and the Void.
The Trial Ban with the Invoker.
Yeah, I like the Invoker Ban a lot. It's a great Miracle hero that combos well with the Void.
Yeah, just one of many for him.
I feel like they have to ban Puck now.
I feel like they have to have 10 bans.
He played a really good Puck earlier. It's another hero that has extra mana. He can be really aggressive. It's good against Phoenix. Pretty good against Mirana.
This is the thing, when you have a superstar player like Miracle, or you have a player that tends to take games like really, really late and is known for, you know, carrying his team to victory, I feel like a lot of teams make the mistake of trying to ban out his heroes. And usually that player plays more heroes that you can ban out. I think the correct approach is not to ban out his heroes or to focus a lot of attention on him in the early game. The correct approach is to make sure that during his power spikes, you have a draft that can deal with it. So instead of, like, in the heydays of anti-mage, instead of constantly ganking the anti-mage's lane, you make sure that your late game carry can go toe-to-toe against an anti-mage.
Okay, so that's the Miracle Hero. Not the most synergy with the Void.
You sure it's not offlane Void?
It could be offlane Void. It also could be safelane Juggernaut. It could be a no-tail hero.
He does play a lot of Jug, I feel. It's very consistent, provides team fight.
Okay.
You can pick it early and not be punished in a lot of ways.
I mean, I think at this point it could be either or.
Okay.
Yeah, depending on the mid matchup.
I thought just the way, you know, because we were saying how much we would like no-tail to be playing those tempo heroes. I think that's not really the most tempo hero in comparison.
It's definitely not, but it can also fight. If you move away from sort of the Battle Fury builds and you go something like Aquila into Diffusal or something like that, or Vanguard Diffusal.
Yes, a Manta.
So we did see this exact opening from Na'Vi the other day, and they did put Dendi on a Batrider mid. Not sure if they'll do the same approach because they kind of just adjusted it.
Against a Jug, I feel like it's a bit iffy. He's already carried. Yeah. That's kind of hard to gank. So if he gets a spin-off, then your arrow setup doesn't work. And then, although they did do offlane Mirana, so it's not like you're all in on the arrow like a support would normally be. Mm-hmm.
What I like about both these teams so far is that they have left their options very open. It's hard to tell where exactly they're going to lane, who's going to play what.
They've found quite a lot of liking picks, Na'Vi, recently as well.
It's
really good win rate with it as well, 81% of 16 games.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really strong hero this patch, as Team Liquid has demonstrated. I'm surprised that other teams aren't favoring it as much.
No surprise on the Enchantress pick. Na'Vi is picking either Chen or Enchant in the first round, actually, of the group stage.
Yep.
Consistently.
Yeah, like we were saying, you know, that early aggression. However, this does kind of leave you to a point where the Phoenix is a pure 5 now. Because Enchantress, unless he's going to be a pure 5, which we don't really see too often, Art Styles usually actually ends up finding his farm everywhere, but Sonego usually does too, but he gets it through just pure team fight.
Yeah, I think it's fine that they picked it like that. He usually gets enough gold anyways, and this is another reason that OG opened with Crystal Maiden, because they knew that Na'Vi is very likely to pick Enchantress Chen. They would have banned either of those heroes probably in second phase. I don't know if they do first phase, but definitely second phase if they didn't have CM. Oh man, I'm gonna really enjoy this.
We were
game
waiting
now.
For this. Yes. We've been waiting
this
for this.
This is one of those heroes. We've been waiting for it throughout the group stage, and we knew it was coming at some point.
We were saying we feel like teams are holding back on picking the other Titan until the main stage, and now we do see it. So
I thought I saw numbers, and he was at a 0% win rate with three games, but maybe it's the wrong spread.
I know I saw VGR play it once in the group stage.
But they haven't won a game so far.
Yeah, and I don't really recall seeing it.
It's not a full level of insight.
It's also an incredible synergy with the Void. However, you can't move the Spirit inside of the Chrono anymore. Of course, the Elder Titan Ultimate inside of Chronosphere is extremely powerful. And this is actually an approach that I believe the old Secret used to do when Fly was playing for them. They used to use the Crystal Maiden and the Elder Titan together in this unison.
Yeah, the CM Aura is so good for those other three heroes, actually. Yeah. So good for Juggernaut. He can spin more in lane. He can use Healing Ward whenever he wants. Elder Titan needs more mana in the early game. Sometimes is delayed because he has to afford a Soul Ring. And not to mention that it enhances all the magic damage they have with the Void Crystal Maiden and physical damage from Void Juggernaut. It's just super synergistic.
Yeah. I'm wondering if they'll do maybe like a dual lane with like the Elder Titan Void, but I guess we'll see.
I think what we'll see is very similar to how Shazam ran the Elder Titan in the qualifiers, is that Crit's going to take that Elder Titan and sit mid. He's going to throw that Spirit on Dendi over and over again, and then he's going to run up to him and punch him with that staple gun.
How do you feel about this Axe pick?
They need team fight.
They are picking Axe into three melee heroes of OG, which is good.
Only the second time Na'Vi have had an Axe in a pro game in the last 3 months.
Yeah. Bit of a change. Maybe they're going for like having the Axe kind of 1v1 versus the Void in a manner, and then having General playing that Mirana with an art style playing around his offlane. We did see them do that approach in the group stages.
Yeah, it's very likely going to be offlane Mirana, definitely. But they needed something to set up for their fights. They needed an intro stun. They can't rely on Mirana to do it. Otherwise, it makes Mirana kind of bad for a long period of the game. And it'll be able to grab Jug if he spins. They can lock down Void for 3 seconds and get follow up and kill him.
An Axe Phoenix Egg is a tremendous combo.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
Yeah. So even if Jug spins and hits Egg, Axe can still stop him from hitting.
And I feel like this is kind of a Na'Vi like approach. Of course, they haven't picked exactly the Axe, but I feel like the Jirad tends to play those like mid game eccentric heroes that like Furion, Axe. Like, you haven't even seen him play like short lane Beastmaster and stuff, even like Void, just some things that are a little bit out of the ordinary. And I really like that ban, because like Charlie was saying, three melee heroes, you don't really want to be playing versus a Medusa, especially. So right. I like that approach by OG.
So what do you think OG needs now?
They need more damage that doesn't require big cooldowns, because right now their only good damage is like CM ult, Jug ult, a farmed carry Void or Elder Titan ult, and that's kind of hard to land. So they need more consistent damage and possibly some more burst.
Ooh.
This game got so much harder.
Oh, I like this so much.
I'm just always happy to see Tinkers, man. I love the way it looks with the Aghanim Scepter. Just the laser bouncing and multiple rockets is a pretty thing to say.
This is OG's in a real tough place right now. They need something that's more consistent at shutting down a Tinker. Void is okay, not great. We've seen that before. And then they need something that...
good gap close.
Can lane against the Tinker as well. Like, and then it's... So it'd probably be a miracle hero, but... And he tends to play a little more greedy, and then all three cores need levels, need farm.
Okay, well, it's with Jug Void. So
Miracle Mag. Have we seen this?
I mean, why not? He can play like 115 heroes, I'm sure.
Have we ever seen him play this competitive, though?
I'm really not sure.
I think I've seen No-Tail maybe play it for them before, but
they haven't played it in the last 3 months anyway.
All right.
Dicey. This is dicey for OG.
It is. Okay. Thank you very much, Charlie, Fault, and of course, Purged. We are done on the panel. How is this going to go down? Let's head over to our commentators now for OG versus Na'Vi. It's Merlini, and for the first time today, Toby won!
Thank you very much, Red. Yes, it's absolutely great to be here. We have ourselves one hell of a matchup. We have Na'Vi, the guys that won TI1, but have struggled to actually win any Valve events since that point. You got OG, the major winners. They come here. Both teams have picked up a little bit of form as well. Who's really got the edge here?
I think OG has this.
All right. You have OG? Well, let's go find out. We're going to go straight into the game. Na'Vi going up against OG. I can't wait for it.
Na'Vi versus OG.
All And it is time to get underway. Na'Vi versus OG, game number one of this best of three. The winner's bracket is where both these teams ended up after Na'Vi actually topped out of their group. I don't think many people would have predicted that they would be here coming into this tournament after, especially like OG, who 3-0'd them at Dream League.
Yeah, that's why I have to favor OG in this matchup. We already see a misclick, it seems. Miracle with a clarity popped as he was trying to get pulled some tangos. I think they have a lot of good ways to deal with the Tinker. Most importantly, you want to stop his Blink so he can just constantly move about in the trees. The Elder Titan is really good at that, and Chrono especially is great at locking him down.
Let's actually talk about the big problem, which is a hero which both these teams played a lot, the Phoenix. So we look at him, how is OG really meant to keep Sonaco out of this fight? And is he actually a big problem? Because you're running a full melee lineup plus a Crystal Maiden up against Nova.
Name of the game, as usual, is positioning. If they can catch him in one of the big AoE ultimates, he's certainly going to die, but Sonaco, one of the best support players, period.
Yeah.
Doubt he'll be caught so easily.
I'd like to see how it's all going to unfold. And of course, Na'Vi, this draft actually started to look pretty interesting and very familiar to us until that Tinker pick came. And we're like, okay, we'll be general off lane. Like, we expect some kind of like strong safe laner. And then Axe comes in, the Tinker comes in, and Na'Vi just changed it up a little bit. But, well, we're going to find out how it's all going to unfold as the lanes come in. So it will be Miracle taking up the Magnus, who was the last pick for OG, up against Dendi in the mid.
And you said that Na'Vi's draft is kind of familiar. I think OG's as well. They almost always have some sorts of sustain. They have the CM, plus the Juggernaut Healing Ward. Usually they have the Phoenix, but with this sustain, they can always push high ground early. And they are known for pushing very early, 25, 20 minutes, sometimes ending the game.
So with that tempo control, they can look for the opening. Damn, Miracle and Dendi, they're just trading blows here in the mid, keeping Miracle as low as they possibly can. Want to watch that bottle timing as well for him, not to mention the BT's timing. Because that's when both these heroes, if you think about it, like for the critical times, Dendi, you're looking for his BTs, you're looking for his progression into big mana items. And Miracle, is the Blink Dagger going to be that impactful?
Of course.
I know it's a Blink Dagger Magnus, it should be impactful anyway. But like, what's the primary target you're searching for? Like, who can you go on when you first want to rotate off as the Magnus?
It's always Tinker. When you take down a Tinker, you prevent the march, so you can actually take objectives. He's pretty much the biggest one that can stop the pushes. You always have to worry about the Phoenix at some point. But with the mobility of the Tinker, he can split push all three lanes.
Odd style, he's bringing the army north. They're looking for crit. They kind of find him, however. Well, at least if they do find him, General not wanting to throw out the arrow. Too busy just trying to defend his own camp. Also, not a bad D ward there from Na'Vi, able to take out that high ground ward, which was watching over General's small camp. So we can now farm in a little bit more safety.
And arrow mid, Miracle with the skewer on bottom.
Yeah, he's just keeping Sonaco away from that rune.
Miracle actually just narrowly dodged an arrow around like 120, and most of that is because they're flying blind in the top lane.
Mm-hmm. Well, Na'Vi now fly. The army is right behind him. General is there. Artstyle will slow him down. The arrow is going to connect. As Fly needs a little bit more space, able to get it. No-tell creates a buffer with the spin. Even though Fly is low, he still wants to stick around and help out. No-tell also copping a lot of damage for this. And the only thing which really lost here for Na'Vi was Artstyle's army.
Self CM not really able to jungle. They have plenty of sustain though. CMR plus healing ward should be A-OK in this top lane. And not really too many stacks coming out from Na'Vi. Want to get that BOTs up ASAP.
And everyone's sitting on the edge of their seats right here. Kind of watch Crit's also progression. Right now with 3 minutes in, he's only got half a level over on the ET. Like, how is Crit's progression meant to go? Is it meant to come through rotations? Is he meant to prep for stacks and then just leech experience?
The support's job in the early game is to nullify the presence of the Enchantress. Artstyle has been known to wreak all sorts of havoc on the Enchantress. So as long as the Enchantress isn't doing that much, you don't really worry about levels on ET. He's not a priority.
Well, the Enchantress has still had some influence, but it hasn't found a kill at least. So it's just Artstyle rotating around, and Crit looks like he'll continue to run after him. But Artstyle won't stand for that one. Sonaco, that Phoenix, it's been one hell of a hero through the last couple of weeks. Dendi skewered back underneath the T1 tower. The spear is down, he's in trouble. The Sunray will turn on. Miracle trying to keep up with it. The range is there. Miracle! He'll find the kill. The Sunray still on it, but it won't get through. Thanks to the storm from Crit. Now Sonaco's on the run. Miracle's looking for two, and he's going to get it as well. A double kill for OG to start up against. against Na'Vi here in game one, and then make it thrice as No-Tail will catch out Mirana on the top lane with the help of the Crystal Maiden.
One of the most highly anticipated mid matchups, old school Dandy versus new school Miracle. Fairy Fire pulling through for him.
And Miracle. So patient as well until Dedi's slightly out of position, back under that T1 tower. He knew what he was up against too, that ET rotating down, it was the Enchantress who was battling him before that ended up happening, but he still tries to contest and be strong inside the lane. It's been a pretty damn good lane for Dedi so far. If you look at that CS, he's well ahead of Miracle. So that kill kind of brings Miracle, I say though, two kills, brings Miracle back in line with the Tinker.
And Na'Vi throwing more resources here, dropping the Observer Ward. Hoping for an arrow from General to neutralize this lane. They have two wards set up there for him.
Gotta keep those eyes up. Looks like Dirar and Moon also having a small little tussle on bottom lane, bringing themselves down to half life before Moon was just able to jump away. We haven't actually really, like, we've been seeing Moon here and there, but we haven't really seen his rotations yet. That level 6 is coming, and so will Moon.
But look how deep crit is. He smoked into the opposing jungle, trying to get eyes on this Enchantress. Maybe pop a smoke if he's lucky.
Well, at least he still gets a deep Observer Ward, even if he doesn't find that kill. Also talking about the other Observer Wards, it's Snako. Put one down that cliffside. Looking to keep eyes in the bottom lane and potentially catch out Moon. A difficult target to do so, but it's the mid lane where Dendi stomped on for the moment. Miracle gonna skewer him back right now. He puts down the Master of Machines, but Dendi is already dead. There was nowhere to go apart from down.
Na'Vi typically has just so much support in the mid lane, but with that smoke, knowing that no supports are there, that's just a pretty easy kill. And they also scout out the stacks. They're just setting up to gank those stacks at any moment's notice. Juggernaut, one of the best heroes to invade the opposing jungle. With no creeps of support, Omni Slash surely going to get a kill or two.
So how do you ensure Dendi's farm? Do you swap him out with Didira?
I think they just need to park the Phoenix there is more likely. The Sunray was really close to actually getting the first blood on Miracle and saving Dendi.
Oh, Miracle. Oh, Ricky might have left the game, but Miracle, he starts up the RP, but Dendi was just out of range of it, and he couldn't find the perfect angle. If he moved any closer, he would have come in range of that tower. And Snako, in return, is actually throwing down a Sentry Ward. Well, unfortunately for him, he won't find either of the Observer Wards. OGs have such great depth of vision at the moment. They see both Snako and Artstyle moving to the side, and another Sentry Ward from Snako is going to go begging as he cannot find those obs of OG.
Yeah, the last move that they made in the mid was just very aggressive, and it was with really great execution, so he knew that they were very, very confident moving up that high ground, which is not something that you see during nighttime without vision. But with those vision that Crit is placed deep in the jungle, they can do whatever they want.
I'm loving this posturing from No-Tail, and then he turns into a rotation. He was first staring down the barrel with General because he's got Omni Slash up. He wants an isolated hero, and Dendi is probably going to be exactly that. Backing up, the creep wave is there, however. So there's no easy option for No-Tail. But he also knows that Dendi is alone thanks to those two Observer Wards.
These two supports have set behind Moon for the last 30
Dendi's
seconds.
Dendi is actually dead. Omni Slash to go. Followed up with a spin. There's no way for him to really survive that. Miracle gonna skewer forward. Snako, no, he'll be able to just, okay, with the Sunray and the damage from the tower, Miracle's gonna drop very low. His bottom lane with Astro's hand. Getting both Void and the Elder Titan. Flies on the run, but now, finally Na'Vi get themselves on that board. Running back behind the town, they can use the Centaur to tank it up. With the Sada Blast there, they're gonna find another one. ET, Void, and CM all on the sidelines.
Wow,
but you keep trading off your Tinker for now what's the first kills of the game.
What's crazy about that is OG knew that gank was coming, and they were trying to set up with the Faceless Void, but Axe is just 2'd on Tinky. Where's their damage coming from? 1 point in natural order doesn't do anything versus the
style?
40 damage Axe.
That's very, very low.
They need CM6 ASAP. It combos so well with RP, with ET Ultimate, and Chronosphere. Without the Juggernaut having his Omni Slash, there's just not that much damage flying around the map.
So just patience until his back off cooldown. Work around these ultimates. Richie had the two big team fight controllers.
They've been doing a really good job of handling Artstyle, though.
Yeah, normally Artstyle is the man who dictates the pace of the game for Na'Vi. That was one of the big reasons why they looked towards the Chen, they looked towards the Enchantress. And now, well, he's got the two assists thanks to the successful kills on bottom lane. but they have to deal with a Blink Dagger over a Miracle. So that Magnus Blink, that big initiation's available for him.
Yeah. They maybe with the Moonlight Shadow they can dodge this. I don't see any dust on the side of OG right now.
You're right.
The General has picked it up at level 6. But here we go with the first potential Blink RP, Miracle and Crit.
Yep, smoke up right behind that Tier 2 tower looking for an opening. The question is just how obvious will it be to Na'Vi? They've only got two real wards which look over the river, which is in the top as well as on that bot lane behind the T1 tower.
Three
but yeah.
heroes are showing, though.
Okay, yeah.
You might think that Magnus is just doing stacks right now to get his Blink Dagger. You don't actually know when it's going to come out, but maybe the March will
here
stop.
Here they come. That Observer Ward sees a hell of a lot. Miracle going to jump in, goes to the skewer, Brooks brings him in range of Zaneko with the Spirit down. Danny's gone as well. OG, a perfect execution. Na'Vi trying to Moonlight Shadow and escape out of it, but it was over before the Shadow had effect.
Man, that's brutal in dealing with the Tinker. Thing about killing him right now, he has very, very little reliable gold. And when you're saving him for a big ticket item like BOTs, it's not like you're going to be Magnus and, you know, maybe buy a Bracer, buy a Wand before you're going for that. You need that BOTs.
And you called it perfectly with the control of Dendi being a priority target. And then the first big movement coming out from the Magnus, he finds Dendi as well as Sineko. So not just taking the main prize, taking the consolation. Attempted denial won't work, and OG with five heroes secure that tier one tower in mid.
And I must commend Crit for his early game. Just mirroring the Enchantress's movements in the early game, setting up those wards just so that 9-minute RP would connect with very high success rate. Miracle gets...
He has to wait. He has to wait 5 seconds thanks to the good arrow from General. The skewer will get him back out of the river and away from that double damage rune.
They don't really have a good way to prevent the RP from going off into a fight. They have to jump on him with the axe.
This feels like bait again. Like this time they put Dendi hanging out and you move Dirara and Sineko onto the cover of smoke just behind that tier 1 tower. They're hoping for a target. The ET is probably going to be the only one they can go on. But they have to understand too, the OG support can arrive quickly and you have to keep in mind that Chronosphere from Moon. This can shut down Na'Vi's aggression very, very quickly. Whoop. So we'll have ourselves a moment. So far OG seem to, like apart from the small little mishap on bottom lane, they seem to be in pretty good control of this game.
Yeah, I would say that's an understatement.
Oh, we're gonna try again, so restart, let's go.
So going into the series, Toby, how big of a Na'Vi fan are you from one to Toby 2012?
You know, when Na'Vi win a Valve tournament again, then I might go back to what I used to be. Art style, a little bit of trouble, no tail. He kind of wants to go for this one. The arrow is soaked up by the spin, keeps it going. Art style's low, but no tail, can't keep it going. He's got the Omnislash available, but with the creep wave following him down, he just couldn't get a guaranteed kill on Enchantress. So he keeps the risk of the Omnislash in Na'Vi's mind.
And even if he had died there, he'd still be creating space for Tinker. 1,700 gold for him. Really desperate for those BOTs.
He needs the BTs. Like, when you're skipping everything else, like, I suppose he hasn't, like, you still got the Null Talisman, you still got the Sol Ring to work with.
And now OG moving in for the next objective.
General. Quick leap away. It's a little bit of the downside about both the Crystal Maiden as well as the ET. They don't have the greatest control up against the Mirana. It's not that straight grip control. You got the Frostbite, but everything else is the timing with the Stomp. Which
RP is low enough of a cooldown, though, that they don't need it from their supports, especially when you have an Arcane Rune.
That means Na'Vi is not going to try and fight this. OG scan behind the tower just to make sure that no one's going to be there. And this will be an easy T1 tower on bot lane.
If they don't contest, they'll just take Roche out very soon with the healing ward. And Tinker is decent around the pit, but not before he has Blink. BOT's up finally, though, for Dendi, 12 minutes in.
You do have the Blink over on, like, with the Blink over on Didier Ra, and now with the Dragonlance also arriving on Artstyle, they got ways where they can reach in with the damage. I don't know if they can stay completely out of range of an RP as well as a time walk into a Chronosphere. That is a whole different kettle of fish.
They really only have one good way of initiation, though, which is a Blink Axe, which is easily countered by the Stomp from Elder Type or the Chronosphere. Even throwing down a Healing Ward is decent, but the big man is the Magnus with the RP. And I still don't see a great solution for them in the teamfights for that. I think they can hope for a bed of marches, maybe one or two, and then that will disable the blink daggers.
But then Denny also needs that time created. Like, you need Supernova to hit. You need to have, like, long arrows. You need, like, multiple hero calls. This is a lot of things which make this Na'Vi lineup difficult to execute. But they're coming over and they want to have a look at Roshan. They understand the same thing, that this is going to be a critical place. But OG have already left. They've gone back into their own jungle. Back into farming mode. Using the Empower and just advancing that farm of Moon so quickly allows him to actually go for this Trez into Vlad's.
And OG can still off-farm them with just the threat of having Roche. With Enchantress not having Max Untouchable, Na'Vi don't pose a threat to Roshan just yet. Yeah.
It's almost like Na'Vi just want to have OG go in so they can counter-initiate. That'll give him a chance where maybe OG is a little bit lower, maybe they've used a couple of abilities beforehand.
Yeah. We see the Morana going for an Ags right now, so this combined with Marge and Rocket, I think OG should definitely be eyeing a pipe at some point. But it looks like going more offensive, Faceless Void going for the Vlads. We see the perhaps a Veil coming out on the Elder Titan with a double null.
That's a big group up, make sure your team fight's more stronger. Tier 1 tower on the bottom lane is going to be trying to be mopped up here by Na'Vi. Miracle waiting in the trees for anyone from Na'Vi to come in close. There's a couple of pings coming out at the moment. They know exactly where they are. The Spirit Stomp's going to catch Dedura just in front of the T1 tower. They're okay with this right now until Miracle gets the push back. Dedura goes for the call, but he's still completely stranded. You can Icarus dive forward, but it's already too late. The Axe is being lost, and OG get the better trade-off. They took the T1 tower on top.
It seems as if they control the Axe on the teamfights, they just have no response to any sort of jump that OG has.
No-tail. He's trying to push Arcelor away from the creep wave. Damn, that crit from No-tail still doing work. He can just finish the job with a spin. There's no TP support coming in. Even if it was tried, the creep got killed off, and Arcelor tries to go into the maze. No-tail, the Sunstrike. Sunray is not doing enough. And with a leap forward general, well, they can catch out this Juggernaut. The question is, do they still have enough damage? And the answer is no. No-tail could just walk away and get away with murder.
Yeah, nice play coming out from him. I guess if he really felt that he could have spun TV, there's no way they can stop that bar Supernova, I suppose, or a blink call, which he was dead for.
And OG just starting to rack up an advantage. 8k worth of net worth sitting on the Juggernaut. Overall, 7k going the way of OG.
I think they managed to slow down the pace of the game to something that they're comfortable with, and Na'Vi typically a little bit more aggressive, wanting to get more kills, and they don't exactly have the best late game. If it's all in on a Tinker, they can just throw multiple ultimates onto him.
Might feel a little bit more confident in Na'Vi's approach if they had a different stance of the game, like different style heroes. Like I know I was talking about during the draft phase, if you had something like a Bane, for example, that can combo with that Morana, like you get the lockdowns, you get the pick off, then you go back to farming. You make fear on the map for OG to walk around so then Dendi can have space. But right now, like how much of a presence has Dedura really had? Like he blinks in and OG's like, fine, we'll blink and we'll skewer you back in deeper, so no one can really help you. The Phoenix Sunray, ever since that first moment where it's like, oh, maybe this can find a kill on Miracle, you gotta think back to that moment, it's been the same kind of thing. It's almost a presence, but it's not enough to actually get a kill on OG.
Yeah, he seems like he's the only threat right now. Maybe the threat of the Moonlight Shadow can come out at some point, but
where's your follow-up? Like, it's like Moonlight Shadow went to call down, into call, Berserker's call?
Eventually, they may have enough damage with, like, a Tinker Dagon to just instantly burst people. Still, yep. That's very risky without any lockdown, especially versus a hero like Juggernaut, Void.
Mm-hmm. And we're still talking in, like, what happens when Denny's able to reach that. Like, he's got BTs, that's fantastic, but he still needs a maneuverability item, right? Like, he needs to get that blink dagger to get away from Chrono or potential Magnus initiation. Mm-hmm. And he's pretty close to getting that, sitting at 2k gold, now over on the Tinker.
Not if they lose this fight, though, and they're setting up for
that scam. Oof. That scam from OG is down. They want to see him, but Na'Vi, they actually go the long way around. And there's Miracle. It's going to break, but the call, it doesn't come in time from Dedura. Fly wants to turn. They've got a perfect Observer and Sentry on the hillside, so they see Na'Vi coming. Roshan will go down. Juggernaut has the Aegis Immortal. The Nova on the back end of the pit is actually causing problems for Moon, but it's a spin. Dedura gets the call out. Fly's going to go down. No-tail too early on the dunk, but you've still got Seneca with the Sunray, allowing Dedura to escape. They burn the Aegis of the Immortal. diving away. The Chronosphere only controlling Dendy, but with that laser, he can't get the hit off. Dendy Rock comes in, moves so low, and he will drop down. They try and run away now. Seneca is still on the run, away from Notal, with that crew, he's able to finish the job. So OG, they take Roshan, but the Aegis the Immortal does not survive long.
Miracle hoping for a two-man RP there. Phoenix really quick with the dive. And they just weren't able to combo anything. Elder Titan still was not able to use his ultimate. That was a masterful smoke pop. That could have gone much worse for OG, especially with that arrow to lead off.
It really could have. But Na'Vi can still be happy. Now, at least on the top of their net worth, you're starting to see three heroes with good momentum. 6.8 to 6.3k between the Tinker Axe as well as the Mirana. This is allowing Dendy to have more of a global map control. And we'll see OG being tested on this. They got ways they can catch out the Tinker. But do you want to really turn this into where you start setting up traps? For now, with the Empower, they've been moving across the map and just farming wherever the hell they want to.
Well, they don't have the tools to push the high ground, so that's kind of the only way to really deal with Tinker at this point. Blink RP is, it's not easy at all versus the Marge. So Shadowblade is much more reliable.
TP's coming in. This is the bait I was talking about. It's only with two heroes, and Dendy into the trees. Already uses Rearm, but he'll blink away from the stomp and stay in relative safety, but it definitely goes to show that Dendy is not an immortal when he goes for the split push, but with that blink dagger, he can play around OG and makes life very difficult for him. Then finally, they can catch out both the Obs and the Sentry, which was there for OG in the fight.
Seems like they need another way to catch him out, or they can just be content to farm. Looks like Moon has gone for more farmy items.
No-tell. General's fine to stand his ground here, especially when No-tell used a lot of that spin just to come and close the gap between the two of them. Got Moon playing catch with arrows. They're bringing more support now down to the bottom lane. OG feeling a little bit of pressure.
I think with the way that Roshan fight, though, went down, that OG just want to take it late. Otherwise, we would see maybe like a Scepter build on the Faceless Void instead of the Asha.
That is the way like OG does play a lot. Like, I don't have a stat for it, but I know like a lot of their games, they look to end at around the 40-45 minute mark. It's not really closed out in the early game. It's patience until you find that perfect timing to win.
They aren't too scared of the late game because of their scaling. And if things go really bad, they can always just get refreshers on Faceless Void and Magnus. And Na'Vi have no answer for that in team fights.
Yeah. You almost have to force OG into a bad trade-off position then. But for now, Na'Vi can't really force that much. But they are getting more and more space. As time goes on, everyone continues to farm up. Dendy Ra is probably the most exposed here in the mid lane. So Miracle going to capitalize on it. The Chronosphere out for Moon. It's almost like insurance, but Dendy Ra is really, really tanky. Finally, the others are free, and it's Fly who takes the kill.
And a few more heroes gearing up for late game. See Tinker going for another mana item as opposed to fighting item like a Dagon.
What is the build for Dendy here when you look at it?
A lot of people like just like mana items so you can farm more.
Ooh. Snake Oak. Be ready to dive, or maybe he's going to help out General jumping forward with the surprise. General, I think he knows he's dead. He leaps down, or maybe not, with the stick charges. Moon doesn't have Chronosphere because they committed towards the mid lane, but the Shockwave is there for Miracle to ensure the kill. But this is still a heavy rotation. There's five heroes going towards the top lane. Yes, they do catch out the Mirana, but instantly then Dendy starts adding pressure down on the bottom lane, keeping OG looking behind themselves all the time. Talk about OG having to farm those items that allow them to go high ground. Like, do you almost get like BTs and blink daggers? Like, you went the Vlad's early over on Moon with a Yasha at the moment. Does he need that blink dagger so they can catch out the Tinker?
I think they just need to farm more for later. I think if you go blink dagger, it's gonna hurt your farming speed too much. And it's not like Na'Vi are really looking for engagements right now. They're just looking to, you know, sacrifice heroes here and there, take small risks, so and you don't lose Dendy.
So you focus like making your call as almost immortal so you can go high ground and you'll be insanely tanky.
Okay. Get a lot of items. Healing Ward will continue to keep on scaling, and they still aren't going to have the greatest of lockdown. And if Dendy wants to go for a sheep, he's their main source of disable, and then they can just easily lock him down with Faceless Void if they go on Magnus, or Magnus if they go on Faceless Void.
There's a Na'Vi smoke group again, four heroes together. looking to wrap around. OG feeling that something is wrong. They actually just burnt their scan on the bottom part of the river. But Na'Vi has managed to enter into the OG jungle to look in behind. And what are they going to find? Sunako, well, there's your blink call. They want Fly. Moon actually jumping through the arrogance. A three-man chrono, including Sunako. Can he actually get the egg off? No, we can't. No, and Miracle comes through. We're going to follow up here. There goes Giroli as well. Na'Vi is going to get wiped. They thought they were the aggressors, but they're going to be sent back packing. Dendi maybe going to survive this one. Blink that gets off cooldown up on the hill and going home as quickly as he can. Oh boy, Na'Vi were not ready for that one. The Moon Chronosphere absolutely perfect. They really wanted that arrow to control him, and it just didn't reach in time.
Yeah, from the looks of it, it might seem like OG just have two big teamfight tools in Chrono and RP, but even so, you have to worry about the stomp. The stomp will set up for massive teamfight potential from OG, and they didn't even get a CM at the end of the day.
I know how you go against that again. Like you were saying, like you got so much teamfight from OG. That was the great scenario for OG where it all was able to hit. Like, the RP was just the icing on the cake at the end of the day. It was the Moon Chronosphere that just put that gank, like stopping it directly in its tracks. And all they can do is do this. It's almost prolonging. I don't want to say the inevitable because it's not inevitable yet. But with the split push, OG's forced to come back. They're forced to go back into this heavy farming and just keep prepping for that GG moment.
They just need an item that can catch out Dendi. I think a Yule Scepter would be really good. I'm not sure who would build it, though.
You see the difference.
I think Tinker really fell out of favor once Yule's got that small amount of damage to disable Blink. Because once you Yule's him, he's just dead. You aren't going to be able to channel a Rearm into a Blink out. Or build a Yule's yourself to Blink out. It's a very uncommon build.
You just see the difference between the players right now. I mean, we just flagged it up then, the fact that Nurtel, even during that period of time with flagging it, he took his hands off the keyboard just having a drink. This is a walk in the park for them at the moment. Nurtel knows he's practically invincible once that Skadi is done, which is only a couple of hundred gold from completion.
Don't underestimate Sunray, Toby.
You're right. It's very
percentage base pure.
It's very, very true. Sunray is a wonderful thing, but so far we haven't even seen like a Nova. Oh, did you Ra? He's still being attacked in the trees. He spins through, but OG didn't see it. And he'll just TP away to safety. The rest of Na'Vi are already bailing out of here. Everyone is missing on the map for OG, so get back to safety, get back to farm.
And Sunako just out of range of that Tinker Ward. And looks like OG are prepping for that next step. We see a Tinker Ward on the very top side of the map, as well as the very bottom side of the map too, near the Radiant T2. So they're taking pretty good measures. Elder Titan can constantly scout out with his spirit around the edge of the map, so...
Yeah.
If you're Dendi, you don't feel safe.
Yeah. OG won't be caught. Like, they won't be saying, hey, we don't know where Dendi's moving. Obviously, he's normally quite obvious when you throw a March of the Machines down inside lanes time and time again.
Yeah, he's not dying too much, but still, it's just the fear.
Yeah.
The fear of just getting ulted, and they would definitely solo Chrono or solo RP in if they could ever get their hands on him.
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah. Because you can tag team it as well, right? Like, it's like what we saw with, like, when you ran the Enigma and the Tidehunter lineups. Like, I got Ravage at one point, I got a Black Hole at another. No matter what happens, they're going to enable Nurtel to inflict this damage, which is already buffed up. The fact that he doesn't actually have to go for a Battle Fury because he can use the level 4 and power from the Magnus means that these tankier items are also available while still having that bonus damage.
Once General gets his Blink Dagger, if he's getting a Blink Dagger, yeah, he just picked up his Blink Dagger in the base, so this is a second threat of the split push, and he has even more mobility in the Tinker because he can just blink out and then leap, and none of the blink arrows will be able to chase him unless Miracle gets like a blink skewer force to catch him out, but that's pretty unlikely. So now Mirana can add to Na'Vi's split push threat, buy some more time.
Is that when we actually start looking for OG to pick up something like a gem? Because I doubt you're going to have your two initiators carrying dust or something along those lines. So like if he does escape, like you trigger Moonlight Shadow. Now, if you're leaping and also blinking into tree lines, then you're not going to have true sight anyway. There's no Beastmaster, there's no Nightstalker in this game.
I think Shadowblade is a little bit better. Like, Blink is decent, but if he covers and marches, he's not scared of the Blink because it'll get disabled. It's not like you're going to preemptively pop a BKB so you can get a Blink initiation on Tinker. At least not in a regular gank. In a teamfight, yes. But Na'Vi have not really been in a point where OG can teamfight them. Maybe this will change, though, with Aegis number 2.
Yeah, quick and easy Roshan for OG. Na'Vi were definitely not going to try and contest that one.
And they wasted her scan. They used it like right before Roshan popped.
So if you're OG at the moment, you've got Negus Immortal, you're staring down the barrel of 30 minutes into the game, you've got most of the items you're searching for in the mid-game, do you just systematically take out Tier 2 towers now, or are you feeling slightly more inclined that you can push and threaten Tier 3s?
You try and pressure Denzi into making a mistake, whether that's pushing out T2s, whether that's everyone farming the neutrals and making the map black for Denzi. Maybe it's getting a gem and just taking down all his vision. Just making sure that Denzi just needs one mistake, and then after that, you can just like all in on him once his buyback is down.
I'll say that would be the next thing to stare at. Like, watch Denzi's money. How much do you even want to invest into items when you also need to make sure you got enough money for buyback? That Mirana on top lane is still having a free time on the tier 3 tower. She brought that down by about 1/5 of its health. And OG are refusing to come back. They're actually still on bottom lane at the moment. And this is the kind of situation you get into in a game with OG where you know your team fight is so superior that you could just lose out in the game of trades.
That's a Mirana with no right click. She's only hitting for plus down damage.
It's just that little bit of chip, and then she can come back anyway. So Nurtown rips through the tower, does as much damage as that Mirana did in the space of maybe 2 seconds as Mirana did in the last two
minutes. Look how far back these forces march. It doesn't even get to the bottom of the hill, which is really bad, because how are they supposed to kill a healing ward? Nurtown can just take it through.
That's why Alistar is trying to pump out more damage. With that fresh Aghanim Scepter over on him, he does have more, but it's still is a tall order. And Snaco stomped up. Nortel wants to commit. Snaco has to Icarus dive himself away. Turns on the Sunray very early on. So Nortel just backs out through that march and wants to turn and come in again. No healing ward for 27 seconds, so he'll have to wait out before they can heal up and go straight back in. But then again, he also has the Aegis the Immortal as well as a crap ton of life. 2.7k on that Jugger for Na'Vi to get through. While Sunray's down, you feel more confident, starts to spin, beats into the racks. It's like OG won't even want to fight at this point. They'll just chip away at the racks bit by bit, but won't initiate until Na'Vi comes at them.
Yep, this is, you know, they probably saw the 90-minute game, they're like, nah, we don't want to get there. Let's end it now.
There's Nortel back in again. Start the spin. Easy to do damage. They can't do any magical pop on him while he's doing it. And now the melee racks, they have to fortify Na'Vi. But it's over now. And Nortel, they did it. No engagement. And this is right from OG. And Na'Vi, like, what do you can't force the fight, because you're forcing the fight up against an Aegis Immortal hero. If you burn any abilities on him, you got nothing left later on.
Even if they blow so many abilities on him, I don't think he's going to die. He's very tanky. If he's going for an Abyssal, he went for the Vanguard first, just so he's a better Tower Sieger.
So they can come in again and just rinse and repeat. You got 1 minute and 47 seconds left on that Aegis the Immortal, and Nortel will use every bit of it he possibly can. Just spinning and attacking into the buildings. So he'll come back again in 12 seconds and do it all over again. That's OG waiting in the back lines. Na'Vi, they have to do something, and that's what they're trying to do. They Moonlight Shadow and they try and walk out. OG, they feel it coming. And they throw down that sentry ward.
Still a couple minutes left on the Aegis, and if Na'Vi don't do anything, they're going to just lose two racks for free. I don't know how Tinker's supposed to show himself, though. There's a Yule's up now in the Elder Titan to catch him out. Miracle and Moon.
Oh, that arrow is nice. The call as well. No tail. He's being pulled in a little bit too deep. A lot deeper than he really wanted to. The damage from Arstyle really isn't anywhere near enough, but they'll try and do it with the pull back out. D-Rise outside the face while General is locked down by Moon's Chronosphere. You can take it already, that axe. No, well, he does have the buyback available, but expending it at this point. Na'Vi need to save every bit of money they got, so they need March of the Machines to keep OG out.
And a ton of other sustain coming out, aside from the healing ward. Double tranquils on the supports, urns.
It's a 5-second arrow on Miracle, which won't do anything apart from make him cop a little bit of damage from March of the Machines. Again, Nortel at the front lines. That Aegis can't have much longer left on it. As now Nortel jumps in, Arstyle, huge damage already! He's already brought down by the Juggernaut. You get a small arrow on the fly, but there's no way to follow up. The axe is already brought back. So OG, they got him through the tower, the bottom lane's pushing in, they rinse and repeat. The Aegis Immortal, though, will be gone shortly.
And the Dragonlance Enchantress is the best way that they have to kill the Healing Ward. And it still has good amount of duration left.
There goes Nortel's Aegis. So finally, Na'Vi have a way where they can maybe initiate on Nortel and bring him down. And then the call, two men caught out, Moon there as well. Crit's locked in, but the RP from Miracle keeping him out. Denny and General locked together. Denny's down, he'll have to buy back very, very quickly as Miracle skewer away under the cover of the ET splitter. Diddy Rah shockwaved as well as Nova down by the Crystal Maiden. More buybacks arriving from Na'Vi. And OG again, they force more expenditure from Na'Vi. They back out, they buy out more stuff. There's a full pipe now over on a Crystal Maiden. This is a slow, painful death for Na'Vi. And OG not making any mistakes.
Seems like OG just know exactly how to draft versus them. If it's not the CM of the jug, it's like Dazzle plus one and just having this constant sustain. So they never have to back off the heal. They've been sitting outside Na'Vi's base for like the last 5 minutes.
Smack bang in the middle of OG, the Omni Slash, Denny's caught out, he's already down. That is actually a full death. There is no buyback available for the Tinker and the Yule Scepter. Catching the Phoenix, mid Icarus dives, and Aker's gone as well. And OG, they are putting the nails in the Na'Vi coffin, and there it is, GG. OG will take game one of this best of three. They just seem to have Na'Vi's pace right out.
I think Fly just played against him one too many times.
This actually gives me flashbacks to that same Dream League final, the 3-0 where OG just seemed to have all the control. And they came out of that final and they were just like, yep, okay, another day at the office. It's just what we do. And this game, it didn't feel like it was much different. OG never really let go of the reins.
Na'Vi just have individual tools, though. It's like the art style Chen or the Enchantress, the Dendi Tinker, but where's the synergy? Where's...